Hello everyone. The topic for today is introduction to antimicrobials. Right? We'll be looking at introduction and history, the terminologies, the antibiotic discovery versus resistance. We'll be talking about bacteriostatic and bactericidal agents. Then we'll be talking about empirical therapy, directed therapy, and prophylactic use. Then we'll also try and differentiate between narrow and broad spectrum of coverage. The other thing that we'll be dealing on with is general principles of antibiotics, the mechanism of action, combination therapy. We'll be talking about the host determinant factors and the resistance to antibiotics. Okay, antimicrobials are basically the drugs that destroy the microbes. They either prevent the multiplication or growth or prevent the pathogenic action. And they, however, are different in various aspects, right? One is physical properties, the other chemical properties, also similarly in pharmacological properties. Likewise, they have got different antibacterial spectrum of activity. In spectrum, we classify antibacterials as narrow spectrum and broad spectrum of action, right? And they also have different mechanism of action. If we look into the history of antimicrobial therapy, what we find is that even there is documented evidence of extract from cinchona bark being used in malaria back in 17th century. And actually, in undocumented way, it could have been used long before 17th century itself, right? And in 1909, Paul Ehrlich, his quest for magic bullet started. He wanted to treat the parasites by using a magic bullet, right? And that led to the discovery of arsenic derivative salvarsan, which has got modest activity against syphilis. Even back then, he had suggested that antimicrobial drugs would be most useful if the sites of action would not be present in humans, so that selective toxicity would be to the bacteria and not to the humans. Okay. And in 1928-29, Alexander Fleming discovers penicillin. This is called fortuitous discovery because he wasn't looking for the discovery of penicillin. He was doing something else, but then he happens to stumble across that particular experiment in which he discovers penicillin. Okay. Then in 1935, there is discovery of prontosil, which is the forerunner of sulfonamides. And then in 1940, Florey and Chen, they start using penicillin clinically. Okay. So when it comes to the classification of antimicrobial drugs, we can classify them as antibacterial drugs, antiviral drugs, and antifungal drugs. Okay. Let us look at the various terminologies that we'll be using during the lecture. So chemotherapy is one, another is chemotherapeutic agent. Chemotherapy refers to the treatment of systemic infections using certain specific drugs that selectively suppress the infecting microorganisms without significantly affecting the host, right? And we said earlier that even Paul Ehrlich, when he was looking for his magic bullet, right, he was looking for something that selectively works on the bacterial cell or the microbial cell without affecting the host. And because of the resemblance of malignant cancer cells with microbes in that they replicate very fast like microbes, even the treatment of neoplastic diseases, they are called chemotherapy. And chemotherapeutic agent is the agent that is used for chemotherapy. It could be antibiotic or it could be the drugs that are used in neoplastic diseases. Okay. Antimicrobial agents, we just said earlier, they are used to designate synthetic as well as naturally obtained drugs that are used to attenuate the microorganisms. And antibiotics, they are basically called biotics. Therefore, they are produced from microbial sources or biological sources, and they are used to suppress the growth or kill the microorganism at relatively low concentrations in which there is no toxicity to the human beings. Like antibacterial drugs, these are produced from synthetic manner, and they are known to suppress the growth or kill the other organisms at relatively low concentrations. Okay, this is the timeline for the antibiotic discovery. Have a look. What you see in this picture is that in 1908, salvarsan was identified, right? Then 1932, prontosil came, which is a forerunner of sulfonamide. But then it was from the discovery of penicillin, or from like after the discovery of penicillin, that different drugs, there was a golden era from 1940s to 1980s or so. It was called the golden era for antibiotics, in that a lot of new antibiotics were discovered during that time. But after 1980s, the quest to discover antibiotics has fallen down, and there are very few interested parties who are looking forward to discover new antibiotics. We'll go into that issue as to why it is slowing down a bit later on. Okay. Here we talk about the number of new antibiotics which is reaching the market is falling, right? And if we are on the race against trying to develop new antibiotics. Now, right now, because of COVID-19, all of us are back at home, almost locked in our homes, right? And this is because we failed to produce drugs on time, or we did not have vaccine on time. Yeah, COVID-19 is totally a new thing, and we did not have this disease before. But then we had different kinds of coronavirus that were affecting, right? Even the SARS that affected long before in Hong Kong, 2002-03-04, it was a kind of coronavirus. Then again, there was MERS in Middle East Respiratory Syndrome. That was also due to coronavirus. Had we got like effective vaccine against any of them, it could be partly effective now as well. The reason as to why the number of new antibiotics which reaches the market is falling is because the resistance to the antibiotics is developing very fast, and a new antibiotic that is brought about by any pharmaceutical industry will be used against certain infections only, certain infectious diseases only, and moreover, resistance can develop to that particular drug very fast. So that would be rendered useless again. That is why there are very few people who are interested in pouring the money in the development of antibiotics. Long ago, when we discussed about the development of new drugs, we said that $2 billion are needed to develop one particular medicine. So they are not willing to go for development of new antibiotics. Okay, this is the same thing as to why the pharmaceutical industry has reduced production of new antibiotic. One is the resistance emerges too quickly and reduces the effective life of an antibiotic. There is very little profit in that pharmaceutical industry. They still look for profit, right? And the big biology has failed to produce new antibiotics. The increased cost due to more regulation and litigation or lawsuit fears and government restriction on use, because like there are antibiotic stewards program which allow new antibiotics to be kept in reserve, and then they should be used in only certain circumstances. Okay, have a look at this slide. This is a picture of a website that was released back in 2017, right? Then WHO then published news saying that WHO is looking for new antibiotics, and there are certain microorganisms which urgently need an antibiotic, right? So this was the news of 2017. They had published 12 different and 12 different pathogens. Like they had set priority one, critical. Here it says critical. Then this says priority two, high, and this says priority three, medium priority. Okay. So there were different groups of drugs, different groups of microorganisms which needed new antibiotics. And fast forward now, even in 2020, they still say that the lack of new antibiotics is threatening the global effort to contain the drug-resistant infections. Okay, we said that the emergence of new drugs or the development of new drugs is relatively rare, right? So this is a new news from 2015. You see that the antibiotic called Texobactin was discovered, and this is a totally new class of antibiotic that was discovered. People, scientists were very much positive in that we had a new class of antibiotic after a long, long time. Similarly, in 2020 again, right, a new antibiotic called carbamycin was found, and this is again going to be a new thing. But then the way the new drugs are coming is very, very slow. Okay, have a look at this chart. This picture shows as to when the different drugs were discovered and how long did it take for the resistance to emerge. Okay, if you see out here, let's just start with penicillin. Penicillin was discovered back in 1928-29, right? and it became the clinical use of penicillin began only in 1940 by Fleury and Chain. But then in 1941 itself, there was emergence of resistance. Similarly, sulfonamides was discovered, the prontosil was discovered in 1932, and by 1942, there was development of resistance. We can see cases where the development, like macrolides, it was discovered in 52, and by 53, there was development of resistance. So development of resistance is something that is happening very, very fast, right? Yes, because the microbes, they develop very, they mutate very fast, and again, their growth happens very fast. Again, for that reason, the development of resistance might also be happening on a fast level. So what is the international response to the global spread of antimicrobial resistance? The basic idea is to improve the standards of antimicrobial prescribing so as to prolong the existing antimicrobial drugs and vaccines. And making new vaccines, prevention by improved infection control. You might hear of infection control committee in different hospitals. There is a global alliance on antibiotic work, and this is also doing its work in Nepal. There are various bodies that are working on it. Okay, let us have a look at different terms called bacteriostatic and bactericidal. Right, bacteriostatic is the term that is used for those drugs which inhibit the growth of microorganisms. And when the microorganism, they just inhibit the growth of microorganism, what happens is that there is still some microorganism in the body that caused infection in the first place, right? So the body depends upon the natural host immune system in order to kill the remaining bacteria. Chloramphenicol, clindamycin, tetracyclines, they are often called to as bacteriostatic drugs. The second class is bactericidal. These drugs, they are known to kill the microorganism on their own. Therefore, they do not need assistance from the host immune system. So even if the host immune system is compromised, in case of immunocompromised people, right, the bactericidal drugs are going to kill the bacteria on their own, not relying on the host immune system. The example is beta-lactam, aminoglycosides, rifampicin. They are different drugs. Earlier, when we defined bacteriostatic and bactericidal, we said as if there is a clear-cut differentiation between bacteriostatic and bactericidal, right? But then this clear-cut difference is only seen in vitro test, right? If we do carry out in vitro test that is outside the body, then we see that the bactericidal drugs and bacteriostatic drugs, they are there. But then if we see this under living conditions, then the line between bacteriostatic and bactericidal almost seems to merge. So it becomes of lesser use, in that same drug can be bacteriostatic in one concentration and bactericidal in the another concentration, right? And same drug can also be bacteriostatic for one particular agent, one particular bacteria, and not be and be bactericidal for another group of bacteria. And then again, there were certain diseases like endocarditis, meningitis, osteomyelitis, which earlier was thought that bactericidal drug is needed because for the treatment of endocarditis, meningitis, and osteomyelitis, one needs bactericidal drug. But then later on, it was found that even bacteriostatic drugs were good enough for the treatment of such diseases as well. So the basic idea is that the clear-cut difference between bacteriostatic drug and bactericidal drug is there in vitro only, and in vivo, this clear-cut definition somehow is gone. We just mentioned the endocarditis, meningitis, osteomyelitis, right? So these are the traditional bactericidal agents that were used. However, the alternative bacteriostatic drug are also equally effective in these three cases, okay? So here is a picture of bacteriostatic and bactericidal agents with different examples, okay? Chloramphenicol, erythromycin, clindamycin, sulfonamides, tetracycline, trimethoprim, they are all bacteriostatic agents, while aminoglycosides, beta-lactams, vancomycin, quinolones, rifampicin, metronidazole, they are all bactericidal. Okay, when it came to basic concepts, we talked to you guys about minimum effective concentration, right? But then when it comes to bacteria, we don't talk about minimum effective concentration, we rather talk about minimum inhibitory concentration and minimum bactericidal concentration. So minimum effective inhibitory concentration, it is the lowest concentration of antibiotic which prevents the visible growth of bacterium, and this is determined by microbial culture plates using serial dilutions of the antibiotics. And minimum bactericidal concentration, this is the concentration which totally kills the bacteria. This is determined by subculturing the tubes with no visible growth. If the organism is already killed earlier, then no growth will occur. But however, if the organism was only inhibited, then growth will occur in the antibiotic free medium later on. So it is the concentration of the antibiotic that kills 99.9% of the bacteria. Okay, now let us look into the ways antibiotics are used, right? There are different ways in which antibiotics are used. The first is empirical therapy, the second is directed therapy, the third is prophylactic use. When we say empirical therapy or empiric antibiotic therapy, what is it? Like, if you have been ill, if you have fallen ill and of infections and have been to a hospital, normally what happens is that their sample specimen is taken for culture and sensitivity, and then you are said that the results of culture and sensitivity will come out from 48 to 72 hours, right? But then in some condition, it may be okay to wait for the results to come out, in that it may not be that severe. But in some cases, the disease may be very, very severe, and you simply cannot afford to wait for another 48 or 72 hours for the results to come out. So what is done is that the person uses the past experience and also the data that is present, right, to judge on the kind of therapy that is effective in treating the kind of infection that is happening, right? This is called empiric therapy. So empiric therapy is the antibiotic therapy that is commenced before the identification of positive microorganism. You have not identified the positive microorganism as such, but then you guess this could be the organism causing the disease. So this is properly the drug, ABC is properly the drug that is going to be effective against it. So you are going to use a broad spectrum drug in the treatment of such diseases, right? This is called empiric therapy. And the word empirical, it comes from Greek word empiria, which means experience. Therapy. Definitive therapy is defined as antibiotic therapy that is administered after receiving the final culture result. So antimicrobial therapy directed at specific organisms should include most effective and less toxic and narrowest spectrum drug available. In case of empiric therapy, we were using a broad spectrum agent in which was able to kill or inhibit the growth of wide range of organisms. But then in case of directed or definitive therapy, we are going for the narrowest spectrum available. This practice reduces the problems associated with broad spectrum therapy, like the resistant microorganisms emerging and superinfection, and they are also known to be cost effective when using narrow spectrum drugs. Okay, prophylactic use. Antibiotics are used for prophylaxis or prevention as well, typically before surgery or before tooth extraction. Prophylactic antibiotics, they are both prescribed. Okay, we just mentioned about broad spectrum and narrow spectrum when we're talking about empiric therapy and definitive therapy, right? So antimicrobial spectrum means basically the different kind of species of microorganisms that the drug can either inhibit or kill. Using a broad spectrum antibiotics, it can interfere with the natural normal flora of the body, and it can cause superinfection of the microbes. Broad spectrum antibiotics covers many potential pathogens like carbapenem. It can be used against gram-positive, gram-negative, and anaerobic as well, right? And antibiotic which is active against single or limited group of microbes, it is called narrow spectrum, like clindamycin is effective against gram-positive and anaerobic only, not against gram-negative. Isoniazid is also active against microbacteria only. So this has got much narrower spectrum. Okay, have a look at this chart which shows the spectrum of activity of antibiotics. Okay, what you can see out here is that isoniazid, which we said earlier, it is effective against microbacteria only, right? Penicillin similarly is effective mostly against gram-positive bacteria only. Similarly, antifungal drug ketoconazole is effective against fungi only. However, tetracycline-like drug is effective against gram-negative, gram-positive, and Chlamydia, rickettsia as well, right? So this is a broad spectrum, while others three, they are narrow spectrum. Okay, there is a term called post-antibiotic effect. Post-antibiotic effect is like, what happens is that normally when we studied basic concepts, we said that for a drug to show its action, the effective concentration of the drug should be above MEC or minimum effective concentration, right? So likewise, here in antibiotics, we used minimum inhibitory concentration and minimum bactericidal concentration for bacteriostatic and bactericidal drugs. But however, what happens with post-antibiotic effect is that even after the concentration of the drug has fallen below MIC or MEC or MBC, there is still a certain time frame in which the effect of the antibiotic will be seen, in which there is no growth of the target organism. This is called post-antibiotic effect, and it appears to be a feature of most antimicrobial agents. There are several factors that influence the presence and duration of post-antibiotic effect, like the type of organism, the kind of antimicrobial agent, the concentration of the drug, the duration of antimicrobial exposure, and the antimicrobial combinations. So in vitro, beta-lactam antimicrobials, they demonstrate post-antibiotic effect against gram-positive cocci, but fail to produce post-antibiotic effect with gram-negative bacilli. And antimicrobials that inhibit the RNA and protein synthesis produce in vitro post-antibacterial effect against gram-positive cocci, and also produce post-antibiotic effect against gram-negative bacilli. There are different in vitro methods that are used to determine the post-antibiotic effect, like colony counts, optical density, and measurement of adenosine triphosphate in bacteria. However, the exact mechanism by which antimicrobials induce post-antimicrobial effect is not that clear. Okay, we also used the term superinfection earlier, right? Superinfection is a new or secondary infection that occurs during antimicrobial therapy of a primary infection. This happens because when we are going to treat a primary infection, we use a broad spectrum agent, right? Sometimes we said that during empiric therapy, we are going to use a broad spectrum agent. So when we use a broad spectrum agent, what it does is that it does not just kill or inhibit the bacteria that are causing the primary infection, but then also kills or inhibit the natural flora and of our body, right? If it kills the natural flora of our body, then the organisms that are naturally present in our body, then that particular space is going to be empty of the natural flora, and pathogenic bacteria are going to come and invade. So Clostridium difficile associated diarrhea is a kind of superinfection. Similarly, superinfection by fungus can also occur. Okay, let us have a look at the general principles of antibiotics. Today, again, as we said, it is just an introduction, right? So we'll be dealing with the mechanism of action of different groups of drugs, as we'll talk as to why combination therapy are used. Then we'll look into host determinant factors that influence the selection and the efficacy of antibiotics, and the mechanisms by which the pathogens acquire and express resistance to antibiotics. Okay, that will be all for today. So for the topics on general principles on antibiotics, we'll be having a different lecture. Have a nice day. Thank you.